Érettségi vizsga angol nyelvből. Hallott szövegértése középszint.
Welcome to the listening component of the Matura examination. The listening material and the instructions are recorded on this CD, and the tasks and instructions are printed in your test booklet. There will be three tasks, and every recording will be played twice. The tasks will begin with some music, and then you will hear, and you can also read, the instructions to the task. This will be followed by a silent period on the CD in order to give you some time to look at the task in your test booklet before hearing the text. Then we will play the recording in one piece. After another short silent period, we will play the recording for the second time, but now in shorter sections and with breaks between the sections in order to give you enough time to write down your answers. Please note that the first item in each task, marked with a tick, is always an example. The whole test is exactly 30 minutes long. Good luck.
Listen.
Task 1. In this section, you will hear the story of the birth of the bikini. Your task will be to give short answers to the questions below. First, you will have some time to look at the task, and then we will play the whole recording in one piece. Then, after a short pause, you will hear the recording again, but this time we will play the text in shorter sections to give you enough time to write down your answers. Now look at the task in your booklet. Now listen to the recording.
2, 3, 4, tell the people what she wore.
It was an itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot bikini that she wore for the first time today. An itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot.
In 1946, Western Europeans cheerfully greeted the first war-free summer in years. And designers came up with fashions to match the liberated mood of the people. On July the 5th, 1946, French designer Louis Reard created a daring two-piece swimsuit, which he called Bikini, a nickname inspired by a news-making US atomic test that took place off the Bikini Atoll in the Pacific Ocean earlier that week. In the 1940s, attractive women were known as bombshells, and anything intense was atomic. In planning the debut of his new swimsuit, Reard had trouble finding a professional model who would be brave enough to wear the extremely revealing two-piece. So he turned to Micheline Bernardini, an exotic dancer at the Casino de Paris, who did not worry about showing off her body and appearing nearly naked in public and who eventually modelled the new fashion at a popular swimming pool in Paris. Thanks to its provocative name and cut, the bikini made international headlines. Photos of the showgirl Reed had enlisted to model it circulated across the globe. The bikini was a big hit, especially among men, and Bernardini received some 50,000 fan letters. Before long, bold young women in bikinis were causing a sensation along the Mediterranean coast. Spain and Italy passed measures prohibiting bikinis on public beaches, but later capitulated to the changing times, and the ban was lifted when the swimsuit became incredibly popular on European beaches in the 1950s. In prudish America, the bikini was successfully resisted until the early 1960s, when a new emphasis on youthful liberation brought the swimsuit in huge numbers to US beaches. It was immortalized by the pop singer Brian Hyland, who sang "Itsy Bitsy Teeny Weeny Yellow Polka Dot Bikini" in 1960. Since then, the popularity of the bikini has only continued to grow.
Now listen to the recording again. Remember that this time we will play the recording in shorter sections.
2, 3, 4, tell the people what she wore.
It was an itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot bikini that she wore for the first time today. An itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot.
In 1946, Western Europeans cheerfully greeted the first war-free summer in years, and designers came up with fashions to match the liberated mood of the people. On July 5, 1946, French designer Louis Reard created a daring two-piece swimsuit, which he called Bikini, a nickname inspired by a news-making US atomic test that took place off the Bikini Atoll in the Pacific Ocean earlier that week. In the 1940s, attractive women were known as bombshells, and anything intense was atomic. In planning the debut of his new swimsuit, Reard had trouble finding a professional model who would be brave enough to wear the extremely revealing two-piece. So he turned to Micheline Bernardini, an exotic dancer at the Casino de Paris, who did not worry about showing off her body and appearing nearly naked in public, and who eventually modelled the new fashion at a popular swimming pool in Paris. Thanks to its provocative name and cut, the bikini made international headlines. Photos of the showgirl Reed had enlisted to model it circulated across the globe. The bikini was a big hit, especially among men, and Bernardini received some 50,000 fan letters. Before long, bold young women in bikinis were causing a sensation along the Mediterranean coast. Spain and Italy passed measures prohibiting bikinis on public beaches, but later capitulated to the changing times, and the ban was lifted when the swimsuit became incredibly popular on European beaches in the 1950s. In prudish America, the bikini was successfully resisted until the early 1960s, when a new emphasis on youthful liberation brought the swimsuit in huge numbers to US beaches. It was immortalized by the pop singer Brian Hyland, who sang Itsy Bitsy Teeny Weeny Yellow Polka Dot Bikini in 1960. Since then, the popularity of the bikini has only continued to grow.
That is the end of task one. Task two. In this section, you will hear the story of a Korean woman who got her driving license at the age of 69. Your task will be to circle the letter or letters of the correct answer or answers in the boxes on the right. Please note that in this task, both answers may be correct. However, there is always at least one correct answer. This means you might have to circle one or two letters. First, you will have some time to look at the task, and then we will play the whole recording in one piece. Then you will hear the recording again, but this time we will play the text in shorter sections to give you enough time to write down your answers. Now look at the task in your booklet. Now listen to the recording.
I'm going to do me driving test, and jeez, I must admit, I didn't do a whole lot of studying for it. I read the book a couple of times, it didn't make any sense. I don't understand them bleeding signs, and I can't reverse from...
Mrs. Cha Sa Sun is a 69-year-old woman who lives alone in the mountain-ringed village of Sincheon in Korea, where the bus, the only means of public transportation, comes by once every 2 hours on a street so narrow it has to pull over to let other vehicles pass. Now, however, Mrs. Cha is an unlikely national celebrity. This short, frail woman, now known nationwide as Grandma Cha Sa Sun, has achieved a record that causes people here to first shake their heads with astonishment and then smile. She failed her driver's test, a 50-minute written test consisting of 100 multiple-choice questions on road regulations and car maintenance, hundreds of times, but never gave up. It was only last November, on her 950th try, that she achieved a passing grade of 60 out of 100. She then passed 2 driving skill and road tests, but only after failing each 4 times. For each of her 960 tests, she had to pay $5 in application fees. For 3 years, starting in April 2005, she took the test once a day, 5 days a week. After that, her pace slowed to about twice a week. But she never quit. Finally, she got her license on her 960th try. Hers is a fame based not only on sheer persistence, a quality held in high esteem by Koreans, but also on the universal human sympathy for a monumental loser. Mrs. Park, a driving instructor at the driving school, which Mrs. Cha attended, noted that perhaps Mrs. Cha should content herself with simply getting the license and not endangering others on the road by actually driving. But she said they were not too worried about the risk because it was the written test, not the driving skill and road tests, that she failed so many times. Once she got her license in May, Hyundai Kia Automotive Group, South Korea's leading car maker, presented Mrs. Cha with a $16,800 car. Mrs. Cha now appears on a primetime television commercial for Hyundai.
It doesn't mean 75 if I fail. Well, that's okay. I can always do it again another day. And if I pass.
Now listen to the recording again. Remember that this time we will play the recording in shorter sections.
I'm going to do me driving test, and jeez, I must admit, I didn't do a whole lot of studying for it. I read the book a couple of times, it didn't make any sense. I don't understand them bleeding signs and I can't reverse round.
Mrs. Cha Sa Sun is a 69-year-old woman who lives alone in the mountain-ringed village of Sincheon in Korea, where the bus, the only means of public transportation, comes by once every 2 hours on a street so narrow it has to pull over to let other vehicles pass. Now, however, Mrs. Cha is an unlikely national celebrity. This short, frail woman, now known nationwide as Grandma Cha Sa Sun, has achieved a record that causes people here to first shake their heads with astonishment and then smile. She failed her driver's test, a 50-minute written test consisting of 100 multiple-choice questions on road regulations and car maintenance, hundreds of times, but never gave up. It was only last November, on her 950th try, that she achieved a passing grade of 60 out of 100. She then passed 2 driving skill and road tests, but only after failing each 4 times. For each of her 960 tests, she had to pay $5 in application fees. For 3 years, starting in April 2005, she took the test once a day, 5 days a week. After that, her pace slowed to about twice a week. But she never quit. Finally, she got her license on her 960th try. Hers is a fame based not only on sheer persistence, a quality held in high esteem by Koreans, but also on the universal human sympathy for a monumental loser. Mrs. Park, a driving instructor at the driving school, which Mrs. Cha attended, noted that perhaps Mrs. Cha should content herself with simply getting the license and not endangering others on the road by actually driving. But she said they were not too worried about the risk because it was the written test, not the driving skill and road tests, that she failed so many times. Once she got her license in May, Hyundai Kia Automotive Group, South Korea's leading car maker, presented Mrs. Cha with a $16,800 car. Mrs. Cha now appears on a primetime television commercial for Hyundai.
It doesn't mean 75 if I fail. Well, that's okay. I can always do it again another day. And if I pass.
That is the end of task 2. Task 3. In this section, you will hear a conversation about a language learning technique called the parrot and overshadow method. Your task will be to decide whether the following statements are true, false, or we do not know because the text does not say, and write the appropriate letter in the boxes on the right. Write A if the statement is true, write B if the statement is false, and write C if the text does not say. First, you will have some time to look at the task, and then we will play the whole recording in one piece. Then you will hear the recording again, but this time we will play the text in shorter sections to give you enough time to write down your answers. A means true, B means false, and C means the text does not say. Now look at the task in your booklet. Now listen to the recording.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it! By George, she's got it! Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
In Spain.
Peter, you're a far more experienced teacher than I am, and I need your advice. People often come up to me asking, how can I become really fluent in English? I'd like my English to sound exactly like that of a native speaker. What should I do?
Well, actually, very few foreign learners of English can ever reach such a level. And quite honestly, I don't think it's even necessary. But if you want to be able to hear and understand English that's spoken quickly and be able to respond quickly, then I'd say the best way is to try the parrot and overshadow method.
What? The parrot and overshadow method? What on earth is that?
Well, in this method, you orally repeat everything that you hear, trying to sound just like the original speaker. First, you parrot. You simply repeat them. Then you overshadow them. That is, you speak at the same time as them. Don't forget, however, that this method only works if you actually speak out loud.
What sort of materials should the student use?
Parroting is best used with authentic English material. That is, materials created by and also for actual native speakers, with an audio component and subtitles or a script included. Movies, TV shows, podcasts, news websites, you name it, just about anything. As long as it has an audio and a subtitle or a script, and it's not too long, you can use it.
But how exactly do you do it?
Well, this is how it works. First, you choose your material. Then close your eyes and just listen to the audio, trying to understand as much as possible. Then read the subtitles or script. Then replay the audio, pausing the audio after each sentence. Repeat after the speaker. That part is parroting. Repeat many times until you get good at this. Then repeat the audio one last time, this time speaking at the same time as the speaker. That's what I mean by overshadowing.
Sounds quite convincing to me.
I think this method works for most students, if they do it on a regular basis. Well, and additionally, it's a good idea to make friends with native speakers and hang out with them, eh?
Thank you very much, Peter.
My pleasure.
Now listen to the recording again. Remember that this time we will play the recording in shorter sections.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it! By George, she's got it! Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
In a Spain.
Peter, you're a far more experienced teacher than I am, and I need your advice. People often come up to me asking, how can I become really fluent in English? I'd like my English to sound exactly like that of a native speaker. What should I do?
Well, actually, very few foreign learners of English can ever reach such a level. And quite honestly, I don't think it's even necessary. But if you want to be able to hear and understand English that's spoken quickly and be able to respond quickly, then I'd say the best way is to try the parrot and overshadow method.
What? The parrot and overshadow method? What on earth is that?
Well, in this method, you orally repeat everything that you hear, trying to sound just like the original speaker. First, you parrot, you simply repeat them. Then you overshadow them, that is, you speak at the same time as them. Don't forget, however, that this method only works if you actually speak out loud.
What sort of materials should the student use?
Parroting is best used with authentic English material, that is, materials created by and also for actual native speakers, with an audio component and subtitles or a script included. Movies, TV shows, podcasts, news websites, you name it, just about anything. As long as it has an audio and a subtitle or a script, and it's not too long, you can use it.
But how exactly do you do it?
Well, this is how it works. First, you choose your material. Then close your eyes and just listen to the audio, trying to understand as much as possible. Then read the subtitles or script. Then replay the audio, pausing the audio after each sentence. Repeat after the speaker. That part is parroting. Repeat many times until you get good at this. Then, repeat the audio one last time, this time speaking at the same time as the speaker. That's what I mean by overshadowing.
Sounds quite convincing to me.
I think this method works for most students, if they do it on a regular basis. Well, and additionally, it's a good idea to make friends with native speakers and hang out with them, eh?
Thank you very much, Peter.
My pleasure.
That is the end of task 3, and also the end of the listening exam.